Cuba, a communist outpost in the Caribbean, less than 50 miles from the world's richest country. A trade embargo has kept Cuba poor. During the Cold War, Cuba was the prize stuck between two superpowers. But Cuba has always wanted its own identity. Cuba has given the world cigars, rum and salsa. But the most amazing product are the Olympic boxing champions. Dozens of them. There is a seemingly endless line of first-class fighters. They are the undisputed kings of the ring. Cuban boxers have won 32 Olympic gold medals since 1972. Yet their facilities are spartan. Run-down gyms with ragged equipment is where these pugilists perfect their craft. Boxers don't fight for money in Cuba. Yet with an average wage of just $13 a month, their fighters continue to resist boxing for big bucks under the bright lights of Las Vegas. Why? American sailors and other travelers first introduced boxing in the Havana docks in the early 1900s. But the Cuban boxing odyssey started in 1915 when Jack Johnson defended his world heavyweight title against Jess Willard in Havana. Johnson was a criminal exile, a fugitive, hated in his native America. He was wanted for crossing a state line with a white woman. He was accused of being a pimp. He found a temporary home in Cuba. His fight against Willard at the Hippodromo Oriental Park was recorded by four filmmakers. It was the sports event of the year, the biggest world heavyweight title fight of its day. It ended in the Havana heat of a blistering afternoon after 26 rounds. Johnson was down, shielding the sun from his eyes, and his reign was over. Cuba was on the boxing map. The Hippodromo is gone, Havana's top nightclub. The Tropicana Cabaret was built above the old ring in 1939. In the 50s, American gangsters loved it. It was their type of showtime. And Cuba was their type of fight town. Kid Gavilan was a Cuban world champion. It was a rotten time in the boxing business, and Gavilan was in several fixed fights. But the pioneer of Cuban boxing, a man with style and grace, had emerged in the 1920s. His name was Elgio Sardinos. The world would come to know him as Kid Chocolate. His grave, a venue for pilgrims.
Para mí es uno de los más grandes de todos los tiempos, de cualquier deporte. Y en el boxeo fue el genio del pugilismo cubano.
Kid Chocolate was a self-taught genius who learned how to box by watching the American fighters who punched for pay in Havana. He found his own fame and fortune by fighting with dizzying regularity in New York City and was crowned junior lightweight champion of the world in Philadelphia. A firm favorite in America, but he was very much a Cuban hero.
Este hombre, que fue declarado el mejor vestido del mundo en una ocasión, que paró el tráfico en Nueva York y en París, que estuvo entre la élite del deporte y la cultura en no pocos países, prefería el cerro donde nació todo esto, su pequeña patria. Vino en un avión que amarizó en la bahía de La Habana. Fue aquello, miles de personas esperándolo. Chocolate no solo fue un gran boxeador, sino tenía un carisma especial dentro y fuera del país. Fue una época que la generación que vivió en lo político, en lo económico, en lo social, lo deportivo, lo cultural, solidificó la nacionalidad cubana. Lo hizo Chocolate entre las cuerdas. Y eso fue importante. Pero hay algo más que después seguiré diciendo.
Kid Chocolate's trailblazing in the boxing ring and his deep sense of patriotism have made him a national icon. Other Cubans would go on to win world titles, but none would be so fondly remembered as the skinny kid from Cerro. But a shift in the political landscape would change the country forever. On January 1st, 1959, a young lawyer named Fidel Castro stormed into Havana with his army of rebels to overthrow the regime of Fulgencio Batista. What was once an American outpost of dalliance and decadence became a communist enclave in the Caribbean Sea. Life in Cuba would never be the same. and sport was at the heart of Castro's manifesto.
No pienso que se hayan sentido traicionados. Cuando triunfó la revolución, el gobierno le dio posibilidad a todos los boxeadores profesionales de que se quedaran en Cuba trabajando como entrenadores. Aquí se abolió el profesionalismo, o de que marcharan al extranjero y siguieran sus respectivas carreras profesionales.
The big change in sports that took place in 1962. The revolutionary government established, passed a decree known in history as Decree 83A that said that sports is the right of the people.
And it's a right that the Cuban people exercise fully. Sport is a passion bordering on obsession in Cuba. The revolution placed emphasis on mass participation rather than profit, and free admission to all events means everyone can watch their heroes.
There was no sports ministry in Cuba before 1959. Then in 1962, now there is a new sports ministry with all the support of the state.
El deporte forma parte de la cultura nacional. Es algo que está intrínsecamente relacionado con el sentimiento de nuestra población. Desde el triunfo de la revolución, nuestro comandante jefe ha liderado con su pensamiento y su ejemplo un programa de masificación que ha permitido elevar la cultura deportiva de todo nuestro pueblo. Nosotros tenemos deporte gracias a la revolución. Nuestro sistema anterior, el sistema capitalista, en realidad no reconocía el deporte como una política definida de interés para la población. Había solo deportistas aislados.
Government funding led to a talent spotting network that focused on personal and not just athletic development. The mastermind of this new system was a former amateur boxer named Alcides Segarra.
Toda persona que piensa hacer algo tiene que pensar primero que tiene que ser grande, porque si no, no vale la pena pensar en un objetivo que se va a lograr.
I believe he is the godfather of several generations of Cuban boxers. When these changes came about in 1962, that professionalism was abolished, he was one of the first persons to took a step forward to say, I am here to help train the new generation of boxers. He was not a coach himself. He had to study.
Pero es que él parece que se olvidó que Cuba antes de 1961 tenía boxeo profesional y teníamos buenos boxeadores también profesionales, pero ya a partir de 1961 terminamos con el profesionalismo en nuestro país porque nos dimos cuenta que eso tenía su problema desde el punto de vista de la preservación de la salud, todos esos factores, y nuestra constitución prohíbe el boxeo profesional.
I believe that he has been key in organizing all these boxing coaching programs and organizing the training programs for the boxers.
Segarra was more than a boxing coach. He taught his boxers about their role in the new Cuba. He taught his boxers about pride, patriotism, and they listened to every word.
Eso forma parte de la escuela cubana, que el atleta esté seguro de lo que él va a realizar frente al contrario, los aspectos que él debe desarrollar, y eso es fundamental para obtener una victoria.
While Segarra is the chief architect of the Cuban system, he was heavily influenced by the training principles and techniques of Cuba's new communist allies, the Soviet Union. A fusion of Soviet functionality and kid chocolate flair produced a blend that is uniquely Cuban.
The Soviet Union assisted Cuban sports in general and in boxing, of course. But they had their own school. I mean, strong fighters, punch, and, okay, charge your opponent, but not minding too much style and defensive techniques and defensive tricks. So the Cuban contribution to all this, be smart to wave away from punches and counterattack and get your points.
Garvey is open to punches. Blake can get it.
The new approach returned rapid dividends. A mere 6 years after professional boxing was outlawed and a new system was implemented, the Cubans produced two silver medalists at the 1968 Olympics.
And Blake is over, and he's badly over at that. There's a sample of the Cuban punching.
4 years later in Munich, the Cuban gold rush begins. It was at these games that the world first witnessed a man who would become the greatest amateur boxer of all time, Teofilio Stevenson.
He's a superstar, yeah.
Teofilio was a 6'4" Adonis with film star looks and a fearsome right hand that left opponents in a mess on the canvas. He was Cuba's answer to Muhammad Ali, a charismatic character and a brilliant boxer, and a perfect personification of what the Cuban system could produce.
And he staggers over to the ropes, and I don't think his legs will hold him, they won't. Down on the seat of his pants.
Es uno de los ejemplos de que se puede con personas que algunas veces no tienen el biotipo, no tienen en un momento determinado las características, pero con un trabajo que se realizó con él desde el punto de vista de todos los aspectos de la técnica, de la preparación física, pudimos lograr un gran boxeador.
Befitting his matinee idol image, Stevenson's first Olympic appearance would be filled with great drama. In the second round, he was drawn against the American Dwayne Bobic. As the Cold War simmered, the tension reached boiling point.
No matter how much you want to take away politics in a US-Cuba match, it has a political connotation, of course. Bobic Dwayne had already beat Teofilo Stevenson in the Pan American Games the year before in Cali, Colombia, 1971. And then it was the big challenge for a 20-year-old kid from Cuba boxing the big American White Hope. So it was not only the big White Hope beating the communist young fighter, but also the White Hope beating the black communist.
No hacia el pueblo norteamericano, porque yo te puedo hablar, Dwayne Bobic, hemos hablado, yo estuve en Estados Unidos, traté de localizar, es mi amigo. Hace rato no lo veo, pero sí tuve la oportunidad de hablar con él. No es contra el pueblo norteamericano, sino es contra la política.
Teofilo Stevenson took the challenge, learned from his experience in 1971 in Cali, Colombia, and beat Bobic Dwayne very badly.
And this Cuban is handling Bobic absolutely with ease. And the legend of Bobic absolutely being destroyed here. And Stevenson is on his way to a famous victory. And the legend of Dwayne Bobic is completely shattered.
Bueno, eso sabía yo desde que llegara a Cuba, porque lo había visto con otros atletas también que habían triunfado en otros eventos, y yo sí sabía cuál era el recibimiento que iba a hacer.
The name Teofilo Stevenson and his figure became idols, not only for the Cuban people, but he became an icon for Cuban athletes, particularly boxers.
After his Olympic triumph, Stevenson was offered millions of dollars to defect and turn professional. He dismissed the idea with a response that has assured his status as a Cuban hero.
I don't change my people for all the dollars in the world.
That single quote lies at the heart of the Cuban boxing dynasty. The best amateur boxers in the world choosing to stay in the unpaid code rather than pursuing personal wealth in the professional ranks. No other Cuban boxer has had to resist such temptation as Teofilo Stevenson. He was offered a fight with Muhammad Ali. It was made. It was, at the time, the sport's greatest pairing. Ali against Stevenson for millions.
Pero eso hubiese sido una pelea que la hubiese querido ver todo el mundo. Lo que uno tenía un concepto de profesional y uno de amateur. Pero por esa razón, las reglas internacionales dictaron en un congreso el no enfrentamiento de amateur con profesionales.
Amigo mío, personal, yo he estado visitado su casa, he estado con su familia. Él ha venido aquí también. Y yo quisiera también que firmaran para que vean que tengo una foto de él en mi sala. Es una persona al cual yo admiro mucho. Yo pienso que fue muy inteligente porque la gente le decía el bocón, pero no el bocón, porque él sí peleaba y era profesional. Y pienso en una gente que tiene un gran intelecto también. Y precisamente por eso fue que pudo explotar mucho más las cosas y atraía a la prensa hacia él y por eso ganaba más y yo pienso que es correcto.
At the Montreal Olympics in 1976, Stevenson once again romped to heavyweight gold.
Oh, he's got it!
He triumphed the game 4 years later in Moscow to make it a trio of Olympic titles.
Stevenson has got it. The third gold is in his hand. Theophilus Stevenson of Cuba, 1972, 1976, and now 1980.
As Stevenson left the Olympic stage for the final time, his beloved country would go into an Olympic exile, missing the Summer Games of 1984 and 88 due to political boycotts. But Stevenson's global dominance touched the hearts of a nation and sparked the competitive spirits of an entire generation of Cuban kids, all of whom wanted to be like Teofilio. The new generation was unleashed in Barcelona in 1992. In Barcelona, the Cubans announced their Olympic return by boxing their way to 7 gold medals, the biggest ever haul for a country in a non-boycotted games. Leading the charge were middleweight sensation Ariel Hernandez and a marauding 6'6" heavyweight, Felix Savón.
La siguiente, cuando yo empiezo el deporte, yo empiezo por el gusto, ¿no? Porque me gusta. Y una cosa que me impidió en el deporte es los comandantes de nuestra revolución jugando pelota, fútbol, baloncesto. Y entonces, yo cogí, me incliné al deporte de atletismo, después fue en remo, después fue en boxeo.
Savón's route into boxing is typical of the Cuban system established by Segarra. Every corner of the island is searched in a quest to find future Olympic champions. But how does it actually work? How are they able to produce Olympic and world champions year after year? A trip to the Trejo Gym in Havana, a rite of passage for several Olympic champions, is the first building block. What you see are young kids training with old, dilapidated equipment. The raw talent on display is harnessed by the state.
Difícil lugar o cualquier lugar de nuestro país puedes encontrar cualquier atleta de calidad. Nuestros atletas son representativos de nuestro pueblo y están en todos los lugares, en todas las provincias, en todos los territorios de nuestro país y con el trabajo abnegado que hacen todos nuestros entrenadores, todos nuestros formadores de atletas, somos capaces de encontrar los talentos deportivos, ¿verdad?, para llevarlos después a la cima olímpica.
When they see a boy or a girl who are fit to practice sports in general, they talk to them, and then they talk to their parents, and then these children go through tests, medical and sports test trials, and then once they are there, they are asked to go to this sports or the other according to what the coaches think they could be better.
Bueno, niño 9 años y la extremidad su valor personal. La extremidad es la que me entiende, un niño flaquito, alto, que tenga condiciones, eso es lo que se cantan.
Bueno, comencé porque me gustaba y allá en mi pueblo había un entrenador que siempre andaba por las escuelas y buscando muchachos y ahí fue como era mi sueño, desde que muy chiquito empecé viendo el boxeo y aproveché y me inicié en el deporte.
This may look like an ordinary high school, but every kid here is an aspiring Olympic champion. Basketball players, volleyball players, and of course boxers. They're all coached by Olympic gold medalists in the morning before hitting the books in the afternoon. This is the cornerstone of the Cuban sports miracle.
And from there, if they excel in the provincial sports academies and in provincial competitions, then they move to the National Elite Sports Center.
And for fighters, this is it, La Finca, the farm, the pinnacle of the Cuban boxing pyramid. Here is a concentration of Cuba's best boxing talent being guided by the most brilliant boxing minds. All have risen through a highly competitive system and are now in the finishing school for future Olympic glory.
You have, let's say, 24 kids in the Havana elite sports academy. These 24 kids come from all around Cuba. They have gone through all this ladder of, you know, moving up in search, in quest of their dream, right? To be in La Finca, to be in the national team, to represent Cuba.
But to what extent does this system create a moral dilemma? How much room is there for sentiments such as a child's welfare when you're running a school for winners only?
Ellos tienen diferentes resultados en esta competencia, etc. Hay una atención, hay una preparación, que es la que habíamos informado anteriormente.
Cuba continue to dominate their Olympic opposition in commanding fashion. Their methods of early recruitment and clear paths of progression have produced 32 Olympic champions and shows no sign of abating. This seemingly never-ending conveyor belt of world-beating boxers can intimidate the opposition. The Cubans are the best boxers in the world, and they know it.
There's an aura about the Cuban team. Everyone wants to avoid them, but and that can get to a certain individual, I think. If you're not strong-minded, strong-willed, then you can certainly let your emotions get the better of you. And I've seen a lot of fighters beaten before they get into the ring against the Cubans, knowing that they're up against the best boxer in the world. I would think they would have a certain amount of success in the professional game, without a shadow of doubt. Because of the style of boxing that they have, you could train a Mario Kindlin to box over 12 rounds. The way he's relaxed and he doesn't get tired, I bet you he could do 12 rounds in his sleep.
But professional boxing is banned, and the fact that Cuba is a poor country makes the possibility of defection and punching for pay a glaring possibility. The boxers are vulnerable. Amazingly, few have defected. But in 1996, just a few weeks before the Atlanta Olympics, Yoel Casamayor turned his back on the Cuban way. He turned professional in America. He remains the most high-profile defection in Cuban boxing history.
Yoel Casamayor era campeón olímpico de Barcelona 92. Era una de las principales figuras que teníamos nosotros para una medalla de oro prácticamente segura en los Juegos Olímpicos. Y eso, cuando él desecta, él nos hace un hueco al equipo, puesto que ya es una medalla de menos que teníamos. Y él hizo, determinó, dice, no se lo criticamos, cada cual tiene su mundo, pero sí afectó al equipo.
But on the global boxing grapevine, rumors abound that the family of any boxer who defects pays a heavy price back in Cuba. Reports of state-authorized isolation and intimidation are commonplace.
Es totalmente incierto. Jamás Cuba toma represalia contra familias, amigos, ni mucho menos. Esas son actitudes que, si bien no se comparten, se respetan desde el punto de vista personal.
So why do more boxers not take that personal decision? Why, with the world's wealthiest nation just a treacherous raft ride away, are more of these outstanding boxers not tempted to earn millions as professionals? Cuban Olympic champions who even think about pursuing a pro career are forced to consider the harsh reality that if they leave, they can never return home.
Bueno, porque tienen una ideología. Los boxeadores nuestros, su gran mayoría, ha habido algunos desertores, pero por supuesto no es la regla, es la excepción. Boxeador salido de acá. O sea, que ha habido boxeadores de esta nueva jornada de boxeadores cubanos que han llegado al profesionalismo. Ya han triunfado, estos podían triunfar igual. Estos no tienen menos calidad que aquellos que se fueron. Sin embargo, están aquí porque profesan una ideología, un amor al país que representan, a la bandera.
The first big medal Cuban athletes win is the medal of sacrifice. They really go through so much hardships. There are shortages of equipment. Sometimes the gyms or the sport facilities are not so well equipped. But in spite of that, they go through all these, take the challenge, and try to win the medals they want to bring back to Cuba.
Y nuevo campeón mundial en los 51 kilogramos, Douglas Rodriguez.
So they box for Cuba, the flag, the love of the people, and Castro.
Que los contempla orgullosa, no temáis su
El pueblo de Cuba tiene buena amistad con el presidente Fidel Castro, y nuestro gobierno reconoce no solamente a los deportistas, sino igual que en todas partes, reconocen a las figuras que se destacan. Y entonces sí, yo he tenido muy buena amistad y gracias a él y gracias a sus ideas y gracias a la idea de otros compañeros tenemos todo lo que tenemos hoy, por eso podemos vivir aquí así, con esta felicidad que tenemos hoy, aunque no seamos un país rico, pero sí espiritualmente estamos, y sí le debo mucho a él y a nuestro gobierno.
Y entonces, en sí, yo nunca había visto a Fidel Castro frente de mi persona. Entonces resucité cuando él me dio en el pecho y me dijo, no, sí, está yendo éxito para el pueblo cubano, fue que me... Eso quiere decir el aprecio, lo que yo siento por Fidel, por el pueblo cubano.
The love that Cuban Olympic heroes feel from their people runs deep. British Olympic champions can expect huge amounts of money from endorsements. Cuban gold medalists receive modest material rewards.
Bueno, mi vida hubiese sido igual o mejor, no sé. Pero aquí es todo igual por igual y no me siento ni más pobre ni más rico. Bueno, una de las ganancias ha sido el cariño y el respeto del pueblo mío y de mi familia. Esas son de las cosas de la ganancia, como la medalla de oro y la alegría de haber sido campeón olímpico y mundial.
A lo más significativo de una persona, lo más exquisito, ¿no? Que quisiera tener un hombre, he llegado a eso. El boxeo me ha dado todo esa vida.
Mi pueblo y yo pienso, y hoy lo veo mejor que nunca, porque es un reconocimiento permanente. Y me doy cuenta hoy, más que nunca, vuelvo y repito, porque donde quiera que voy la gente me admira. Antes cuando competía me exigían y hoy, sin embargo, reconocen, me admiran y me respetan. Yo siempre pensé que siempre podía hacer más, pero el pueblo me dice que el gran campeón que he hecho.
This is at the heart of the Cuban boxing phenomenon, this adoration. The boxers want to win and bring back medals. They fight for the glory, a nation's glory. The conveyor belt rolls on unabated. Back in Cuba, they could receive a small house or a car from the government as reward for their global triumphs. A meager return compared to the riches on offer for gold medalists of other countries. The next Teofilo Stevenson, Felix Savon, or Mario Kindelan is just around the corner. But with millions on offer in exchange for their ring craft, just how much longer will the world's best amateur boxers continue to do it for the love and not the money?
Muhammad Ali, the greatest. Storyville next on BBC 4. Pero nada más que me gusta la café, que ella me cuela.